H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Now we are trying to understand something called third party tools. It means whatever we are going to discuss in today's session, which are not actually related to Selenium, okay, which is not related to Selenium WebDriven, but these are some sort of things which will be used along with the Selenium, okay, which is not actually part of the Selenium, but these are the tools might be used along with the Selenium. And basically, and these are the tools again, mainly for the developers. Okay, these tools mainly for the developers. Basically, these tools mainly used by the developers. So, you know, there are some people or some organizations might use these tools. Okay, there are so many varieties, so many tools available here. So that's the reason here. First of all, we have to understand the concept. Everyone try to listen to these points. We have to understand the concept. Okay, because there are so many varieties of flavors of the tools are available. So first of all, we have to understand the concept. Okay, whenever you join any company, okay, now if they are using those tools, at that time, you can get habituated to those tools, because there are so many tools available for over here. Okay, so mainly for us, Selenium WebDriver, Selenium tool is important. However, we have to know at least the terminology. What is meant by this tool? What is meant by tool? What is the purpose of it? Okay, like that, we have to know. So if you suddenly come across any word, you may feel that I did not come across this. Okay, so instead of that, here we are going to get the idea what are the different tools available for different purposes. Now we are going to understand that. Okay, so here when I say third party tools, means as I said, these are the tools which will be used along with the Selenium. Okay, and these are the tools used by the developers, and what are they actually? First, let me categorize. Let me talk about the categories. First one is, there is something called build tools. I will explain what is meant by build. Okay, I will explain what is meant by build. There is a reason I said, first understand the concept. Okay, so organization to organization, these concepts will vary. Not these concepts, these tools may vary. So that's the reason, understand the concept. There is something called build tools. Second one is continuous integration process. This is the second category. And repositories. Okay, so we'll first of all we'll try to understand what is meant by build tools. Okay, what is meant by this SIP tool? Okay, continuous integration process, and then we'll understand repositories. So as part of builder tools, builder tools means basically the process of automating the development process. What is meant by this? Automating the development process means, for example, if you want to generally, if you want to create a Selenium scripts over here, what we are doing over here, if you want to build a Selenium scripts, first we are creating a project. And then we are configuring the Selenium WebDriver files to the project, right? If you remember, we have configured the Selenium WebDriver files to the project, right? Then we are compiling in the sense, we are making sure that if there are any errors, we are fixing them, right? While writing the logic here, if we got a red colored underline, okay, we are fixing them, right? Yeah. So for example, now if you observe here, it is giving a red color underline over here. So we are fixing them. Basically, we are not exactly compiling. Basically, we are fixing the errors in the script. Okay, because while writing the script itself, it is showing the errors. Okay. We are compiling and then we are executing. Okay. Once we execute, okay, there are some set of files has been created, okay, and I want to send the results to the my team, okay. Once we execute, I want to send the results to the my team via email, okay. Send results to the team, okay. And as I said earlier, these are the tools mainly for the purpose of the developers, okay. Builder tools means, here we are going to automate the development process. Development process means, here of course creating a project is like one time effort, we have to do it, okay. After that, we are configuring the Selenium WebDriver files to the project, okay. Of course we have, but here, everyone try to understand a point here. So we are configuring the Selenium WebDriver files to the project, right. If you remember, I think we have downloaded 2.4.40.0, right? I think we have downloaded this version. Say for example, there is a new release, say 2.40.1. See here, there is a new release, say 2.5, like this. Okay, now if we we have downloaded this Selenium WebDriver files, we have configured over here. Okay, now we have a latest version. What we have to do? If we have a latest version, we have to do? We have to download this and I want to use the latest version. Here I am going to download this and I am going to, here we have configured 2.40, right? I will remove this, I will configure to this. Okay, that is fine. Now we have configured this one. We also configured JXL files, if you remember. We have configured JXL. Okay, here for us, if you remember, in our case, we just configured Selenium WebDriver files and the JXL files. I mean, we have configured the Selenium WebDriver jar files and JXL jar files. That's it. For our Selenium purpose, we have configured two things only. But developer may use a lot of different jar files. Okay. A developer may use a lot of different jar files, and each jar file may get new versions. Okay, see here we are using five different types of jar files. Okay, just for example, five different jars we have used. Okay, so say each time whenever there is a new version of jar file is coming up, I want to use it. So what I have to do here, I have to check the internet whether there is a new jar file, and if the new jar file is there, I have to download the new jar file. I have to remove the existing jar file. I have to add the new jar file. Yep. Any questions on these steps? I will explain what actually I am trying to explain, but at least this related to jar. Any questions over here? Any questions related to the jar, the points I have explained over here? Any questions? I'm saying, we have used five different types of jars in our project. Okay. And whenever I want to use my project, I want to make sure that whether if there is a new version of Java, jar file is there, I have to remove the old one, I have to configure the new one. Okay. Any questions over here? Yes, I can see your question, but where exactly you have joined? At which point of time you have joined? Fine. Let me give a brief overview of what we have been discussing. Everyone Abdul here, today we are going to understand third party tools. It means which are not related to Selenium, but these tools might be used along with the Selenium, okay, which is not related to Selenium, but these are the tools which might be used along with the Selenium. So we have three categories: build tools, continuous integration process tools, repositories. Now we are talking about the build tools. What is meant by build tools? Automating the development process. Probably you will not right away, you will not understand this definition. Okay, now we are trying to understand with an example here. Okay, so here we have listed down the steps that we have been done so far. Okay, generally, as I said, these are the steps generally will be done by the developers. Okay, here we have created a project, and then we have configured a jar files to our project, and I want to create some data. It's like a test data. If you remember, as part of parameterization, we have created a data. So we have created some data files, and of course here we wrote the programs, and then we are compiling, executing, and send the results to the team via email. Say this is my requirement. I mean, as I said, these are the different tasks that a developer is going to do in his daily life. Okay, a developer will do these are the tasks. Okay, in their daily life, a developer will do these tasks in their daily life. Okay, so we are actually automating that. We are basically trying to automate the task that the developer is performing on their daily task. I mean, these are the different tasks that a developer has to do. Okay, whenever they want to execute, these are the prerequisite. They have to compile, and they have to make sure that there are some data files has to be created. Okay, and they wanted to use the latest jar files instead of the static jar files. Static jar files means, say if you configure this 2.4.0, I don't want to use 2.4.0. I want to check over the internet if there is any new jar file is available. I want to download that new jar file and I want to use a new jar file. Everyone try to understand. See, if a developer want to execute their Java programs, okay, everyone close the other here. If a developer wants to execute their Java programs, the first thing is they have to compile. They have to compile their programs, okay. And if there is any data is required, that data has to be created, okay. Say sometimes you created the data and during the execution of the Java program, that data might be consumed. Say for example, you are creating an order. Say not creating an order. Say you are creating a register. You are registering a user. So the user details, once you register, those details will not be helpful for the second time, right? You have to create a new set of data. Okay, so that is one example here. Okay, creating some data. And here, I want to configure the latest jar files to my project. Okay, I don't want to blindly use the jar files which are configured to my project. Okay, so these are the prerequisites, like configuring the latest jar files, creating some data, and compiling. So if I want to execute a Java program here, say these are the three prerequisites. Okay, and one of the example I have explained them with more details. Like say we have configured 2.4.0. When we are executing the Java program, I want to check the internet if there is a new version is available. I want to make use of that new version in our project. Okay. Any questions till this point? Any questions till this point? If it is getting confusion, please let me know. These tools, I know it's a bit kind of confusion, but we will not use much. But we should know what is meant by build tool. What are the tools available as part of build tools? Any questions so far here? Say clear or not clear, or say confusion, say something. Yeah, here I can see one question from Harita. Is this process done by the developers or the testers? Yes, as I said, Harita, these are the tasks generally done by the developer. But sometimes as a tester, as a Selenium automation tester, we may need to perform this. Okay, so that is the reason. First of all, we are trying to get an idea. Okay. Yep. Here, as part of Selenium automation tester, maybe we might be, because some of the organizations or some of the projects might use these things. Okay, so that's the reason we are trying to get familiar with this. What is the purpose of these tools and what are the different tools available here? Okay, we are going to understand one tool here. Okay, yep. Any other questions from anyone? At least, are you able to follow this? Yep. Anil, is this clear? So here, of course, as a Selenium project, as a Selenium automation tester, basically we will not we are using Selenium web driver files and JXL files. If you really want to use the latest version, we can check, we can download and we can configure it. But here in a real Java developer will work like this, okay? Because in a Java program, they will be using lot of external jar files, okay? They will use lot of external jar files. So if they go and check each and every website, each and every jar file, whether there is a newer version, that is going to be time consumption process, right? And probably in a day, as part of development, in a day, a developer may execute the Java program, say 5 to 6 times. Just assume. Why Java developer is going to execute their programs 5 to 6 times? It means while developing their Java program, if they want to make sure that the new Java program or the new set of lines is executing properly, okay, they have to execute their Java programs, because in their case, here in as a Selenium tester, each and every class here in our case will be independent. Each and every class is something like each and every test. Okay, here in our case, each and every class in each and every Java class is going to be a scenario here. But whereas for them, they'll have some packages. In packages, they will have classes. One class might be dependent on the other class. So whenever they want to execute their Java class, basically that Java class might depend on the other Java classes. Okay, basically while executing, they have to execute all their Java programs internally. Okay, so if they are each developer, say we have five members in a team. Say there is a team of five members, team of five Java developers. Okay. And if each Java developer in a day want to execute their programs, say 5 to 6 times, it's probably around 25 to 30 times, right? Each Java developer in a day, if they want to execute their programs for 5 to 6 times, basically they have to follow these steps, like configuring the web driver, creating the data, compiling, executing. Okay, see here, let me give a color of this. Okay, see, these are the 4 tasks that each time and each developer has to perform. Means, say in a day, 30 times around, probably they have to spend time 30 times. Okay, they have to spend time on above 4 tasks for 30 times, right? See here, configuring give me a minute. Yep, here configuring the Selenium files, here of course for us it is it's okay, but a Java developer might use different varieties of versions. So for each time, or at least in each day, if they start opening the website, and if they start searching for if there are new version of jar files available, they lost a lot of time, right? And creating some data, and say before creating the data, I want to delete the old data. Okay. Delete the old data. Okay, if they are going to perform these steps every day for each time, they are going to lose lot of time, right? Do you agree with me? If they start doing these tasks for each and every execution, they are going to lose lot of time, right? Each developer in each team, say if we have here we understood that five members of a team, and each member in the team, say doing these tasks for 5 to 6 times, so they are going to lose lot of time. So here we are going to automate these steps. Okay, in the build tools, basically we are going to automate this process, these steps. Okay, that is where I said the automating the development process, we call it as a building. Okay, whenever you come across any build tools, means here in terms of Java, I mean in terms of development, here, these are the different steps that we are going to perform in executing a Java program. These steps, like configuring the web driver files, like here we can automate this process. Like it automatically, once we write a program, that program automatically go and verify, go and check the online websites, and it will automatically download if there is a new version of jar files available. That particular step we can automate. Okay, so every time you don't need to go manually, and you don't need to manually check over the internet. The program will automatically do that. Okay, and delete old data. As earlier I said, say we are registering a user, so we might have old data, have to delete the old files and old data, and I have to create a new files. That is also we can create automatically. Okay, here I just give an example. Basically, for the developers, they might have, you know, some temporary files might be created. Okay, once the execution here I was trying to make you understand here. Okay, but in general, for a developer, for executing the programs, they might create some temporary files. So when I say delete the old data, means the temporary files might be deleted. Okay, and then we can create, there might be again prerequisite, we need to have some new files. That files automatically we can create it, and then we can compile, we can execute. So these steps you can automate using some build tools. Okay, this is called as automation. And what are the build tools available means? Now we are actually talking about what are the tools available for the build tools. There are two tools available mainly, Ant tool, Maven. Okay, there are two tools available as part of the build tools. One is Ant, the other is Maven. Okay, and Ant is the legacy, and it is it's a very old version. Okay, and it is a newer version. So here, first try to understand this concept. What is this build process? What actually we are doing? And simply we are automating the development process here. Okay, that can be performed by using two tools, Ant tool, Maven. And this is a old tool. Ant tool is a old tool, legacy version. And here, I said we are going to automate this, right? If you want to automate, we have to write a program for this. That program will be written in a file called build.xml. Okay, in build.xml file, we will write the program for automating this. Okay, the automation of these steps will be done in a program called build.xml. Okay, here in Maven, it is pom.xml. Okay, here pom means project object model. There is some name. I'm not sure, this might be correct name or this might be wrong name, but here the file name is pom.xml. But however, the program will be written in XML in either cases in the build tools. Basically, it is just shell scripting. We use something called shell scripting, and that shell scripting will be written in a XML file here. Okay, so here we have Ant and we have Maven. So now say you got selected for a company, if they are using Ant and if they are using Maven, don't get confused, don't get scared. Okay, as you already know what is the purpose of these build tools. Okay, what is the purpose of these build tools? You will have an idea what is the purpose of Ant, what is the purpose of Maven. Okay, and here if it is an Ant tool, you have something called build. Okay, build.xml. If it is a Maven, you have something called pom.xml. Okay, so that related logic will be already written in the XML files. Okay, they will not expect us to do the programming because it is a shell scripting. I know in the internet there are so many files available. Okay, in general they will not expect us to write the program. Okay, because it is again altogether a new thing. It's a shell scripting again. For that again we have to spend a lot of time to understand shell scripting. Okay, basically in very high level when you look at the program you will understand. But for writing it will be definitely a bit problem. Okay. So now here in our class we are going to understand the Ant tool. Okay, now see here I have listed down the Ant tool over here. Okay, we'll come back to the Ant tool probably once we complete the other things like continuous integration process. Okay, we'll come back to this Ant tool. So in our class we are going to understand the Ant tool, and Maven is also in the same way, in similar way. Okay, now let me start with the continuous integration process tool. Yes, this continuous integration process tool means the name itself is giving some kind of information, and it's a kind of a catchy word. However, say in a team, not in a team, in a project, like who are the different persons that are going to work in a project? I mean, in a project, what are the different teams that are going to work on a project? Okay, say we know developers, right? Developers will work in a project. Of course, testers, just keep aside testers for now. So developers is going to work in a project, okay? And DB, database persons, okay? DB related people, right? DB, database related persons, okay? Developers, database related, and say if our application want to work on different versions of operating system at different browsers, okay? There should be some people called patch developers, or we can call them as patch incorporators. Let me say as of patch developers. In the sense, when I say patch developers means, say whenever there is a newer version of operating system, we have to make sure that our application should be compatible with that operating system. Okay, so how that can be done? It will be generally done by some set of people, patch developers, okay, database developers. Say here developer will write their logic, okay, developer will write, developer will write their logic and they will throw their code into this a centralized database, I mean a kind of, let me say database, not database, or project storing, okay. Say developer will write their program and they will keep in a place. Just assume it is a it is a project place. Okay, project database. Okay, yep, it is a repository. Yep. Here, say developers has write their programs and they kept in a project repository. Okay. Database people write their database queries and they will say they have created this database things and they also kept in a place. Okay, but however there should be a connection between the developer's program and database programs, right? I mean there should be like some kind of integration. There should be some the Java programs and DB programs should be integrated somewhere. Okay, and patch developers will write their own logics and they'll put their logics over here. Okay, so in overall what I'm saying here, say in each day, each stakeholder in the project, okay, or each each team in the project will push up their logics, artifacts to the project repository. Right, what I'm saying here, for example, in a project we have different teams, developers, database, patch developers, some integration developers and all. Assume there are different teams, okay, each team pushing up their logics into a project database or project repositories. Okay. Say for example, developers yesterday developer has 5 programs and DB say 3 programs and patch developers say some 7 and integration say 2. Just assume these are the yesterday's set of programs that we have yesterday. And today developer has created 2 more, say we have 7. And say DB has created 4 and patch say 7 only and say integration say we have 3. Okay, so these are the yesterday's programs that we have in our project repository and say today we have. So each team adding something to the project database, right? Each team's adding something to the project database. Yep. If you all remember, I hope everyone knows what is meant by regression testing. Let me come back to this topic again here. I'll come back to this topic again because this regression is related to over here. Okay, what is been the regression testing? I will come back to the this topic. What is when the regression testing? I hope everyone knows what is meant by regression testing, right? Regression testing is whenever there is a new functionality added, we will make sure that existing functionality did not get disturbed, right? Okay, if there is any new functionality, we'll make sure that the existing functionality did not get disturbed. That will be actually we are going to test in regression testing. Whenever there is a new functionality or whenever there is a change in the functionality, we'll make sure that the existing functionality did not get disturbed. Right. In a similar way, whenever the say yesterday we have 5 programs and the 2 programs Java developers has pushed. Okay. Here DB persons have pushed one more program here. Whenever they push their new logic, we have to make sure that the new logic did not get disturbed the existing logic. Right? Are you able to understand over here? It's like compiling. Say you have wrote some four programs and say tomorrow you written one program and that program might disturb the existing program, right? Because of some variable declaration or because of something that might disturb the existing program. So for each push, basically here, developers are pushing their logic, DB people are pushing their logic, patch developers are pushing their logic into the project repository here. Okay. Whenever there is a new push that might be from the developers, that might be from the DB, that might be from the patch. Okay. We have to make sure that the existing artifacts, the existing things are working correctly. Okay, that is where we have unit testing. If you remember, I was saying even developers also will do a unit testing. Okay, so generally for the unit testing, they will write their own programs. Okay, we'll have unit testing programs. There will be unit testing scripts and integration.
Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.